Thank you. Thank you very much. It's my pleasure to be here today. My name is Peter Phippen, and friends, and you'll get to meet them a little bit later on. The first instrument, the flute I was playing, was called the bansuri from India. The next instrument is the Japanese shakuhachi flute, played by Buddhist monks in antiquity as a form of spiritual enlightenment. This is the first cut off my new CD. Well, I guess it's not so new anymore. Came out in January on Canyon Records, called Night Song. This is called Blue Sunset. Thank you. This next instrument has lived with me since 1997. It was made by my friend Butch Hall from Weatherford, Texas. It's pretty much my favorite Native American flute. The Native American flute, as you well know, was played by lovesick young men to win their lady fair. If a young man loved a young woman, he would play this instrument after he had practiced for a very long time so he could express his innermost feelings. If the young woman liked the young man, she would go outside and offer him her blanket, and the two would get in the blanket and snuggle. This would be okay, it'd be her choice. If she did not like the young man, she would send her mother out there, perhaps with a big stick, to pound on him and drive him away. Anyway, I was with Butch and Laura down in Lubbock, Texas, a few years ago at one of their shows. And that's when this piece came about. I rarely write pieces, I just improvise. But this is one of my few written pieces. The working title is called Lubbock Lullaby, but on Night Song it's simply called Lullaby. And this is dedicated to a dear friend. Thank you. Thank you very much. If Ash is still here, perhaps he'd come join me on a Japanese shakuhachi piece pitched a little flat of E. We tried this one out in Oklahoma a couple weeks ago. I really enjoy playing with Ash, and you're in for a real treat when you hear him play. That's why I've asked him to come up and do this last number with me. I've been very fortunate to make his acquaintance this summer in Taos, New Mexico. And like I said, you're in for a real treat. This is a pre-World War II Japanese shakuhachi.
Thank you.
Ash, thank you, Sai. Thank you. It's been my pleasure to play for you this evening, and now I'll turn the show over to Ash.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to tonight's performance. And I wanted to, before we have an intermission, I wanted to play you the didgeridoo as a solo instrument without any accompaniment at all, so that you can hear the space that it takes up. After the intermission, we have more music for you. And in particular, I was invited to bring my multimedia performance, part of my multimedia performance, here with me tonight. So that will be most of the second part of this evening's entertainment. And right now, before we take that intermission, I'm going to play for you a solo piece. And this is a rhythm from my culture, the Aboriginal culture of Australia, the Larrakia people in particular. We're a coastal group of people from the Northern Territory of Australia, right up in the middle of the country, in the very north, close to the equator. So right in the middle. Right now, we're approaching into summer in the build-up season, so lots and lots of storms at this time. So it's nice to be here in the cooler weather. And so this is a rhythm, very ancient rhythm, and it's a yam song, and yams are a food source for us under the ground. And this is a traditional rhythm, maybe about 10,000 years old. I'm not going to be able to do that. Thank you very much. And actually, while I'm here, I'd like to play another lower didge. And just again, show you the soundscape. You see, my instrument's all about playing nature. It's about playing the cycles of life. We interpret the seasons and the animals and the way they move, their behavior, their habitats, and the weather through our breathing and bring that to life for the dances in ceremony, what we call corroboree in my country. So when we go out for what we call a foot stomp, that's when we dance on the earth, we call that stomping the ground. And we bring these rhythms of nature, to life through our breath. So we partake in the spirit of that place when we play this instrument. So this is a lower pitched instrument, and these are all eucalyptus gum trees from my country. And they're living, made when they're living, by the termites eating through the center of them. And then we come up to them and knock on them to see whether they've finished the job. And we go, oh, they've only got up to there. Well, we'll come back in another couple of months, give them another couple of months, and we come back again. We hit up here and like, ah, that's it. That's it. So these are young sapling trees, particularly these ones that I have made by Bob Jewett in Australia. These are woolly butt gum tree, and it's a eucalyptus species. Very common in my area, and other areas of course have other trees and different language groups, so we end up trading these instruments with one another so that we can have and play the different qualities of timber that are available all across the north of Australia, all the way from the east to the west. So there's many different varieties, and each one of them is completely unique. Mostly because the termites leave grooves on the inside. You feel on the inside of one of these, and hopefully there's no termites in there. Feel away on the inside, you can feel all the grooves that they've left, and that alters the way the sound waves travel down, and so each one is like the human voice, it's subtly different. So I'm just going to paint a bit of a picture for you here. Now, this is a wetlands rhythm, Kakadu National Park, where I'm from. And that's my backyard, by the way, so you're quite welcome there when you come over and have a look. Kakadu National Park, it's a World Heritage listed area, has many rhythms and many animals living there. And so this is a bullfrog rhythm that I particularly like, that I learnt for a particular dance that we have during the wet season. And in Kakadu National Park, if you were sitting there at dawn, just after the rains, you would be looking out across the water and seeing the crocodiles and the brolgas and the jabiroos flying overhead. And you would hear the bullfrogs singing their dawn chorus. And so this is actually a rhythm that we've picked up from nature that we dance to. And the bullfrogs from Kakadu National Park. You are. Thank you. Thank you very much, and I look forward to painting more pictures for you of my landscape after this break. And I believe both Peter and I have CDs for sale, and you'll find them outside somewhere. And so please indulge in our music, and look forward to seeing you after the break.
And just want to make a quick announcement. This February, Valentine's Day, February 14th, we have a Native American powwow. It'll be our sixth annual powwow, and it's a benefit scholarship fund for Native American youth trying to go to college and retain the traditional values of Native American life. And it will be February 14th, Valentine's Day. There'll be some flute makers there, flute players there, and lots of arts and crafts. So it's a traditional powwow, and we want to make sure everyone can make it out. And before I hand this off to Dr. Steve Mittelstadt, president of Richland College, I just want to thank Peter Phippen, Ash Dargan, and Gene Glover for coming out. And some of us were showing up at the last minute to do this. And hope you're enjoying it. Okay, this is Dr. Steve Mittelstadt, president of Richland College.
Thank you, Jay. Welcome on behalf of the students and faculty of Richland College to our World Music Festival. It's actually a festival going on all year. And every day is an international festival at Richland College. We have students from 140 different countries here who speak a total of about 90 first languages. So this is a microcosm of the world. And throughout the year, this year, we're having concerts like this that bring people from around the world. We started off in September dedicating our new Thunder Duck Hall. And Carlos Nakai, international, probably the most recorded international flute, Native American flute player, came and helped us to dedicate that hall. And so the other sponsor of tonight's program is the Armadillo Flute Society. And so all of you down here with that retreat that's going on, wave your hand and we'll thank you. Four-day retreat being held out in Flower Mound. With that retreat, last year the group decided to raise money for Richland College Scholarship for students who wanted to learn to play the Native American flute. And they raised enough money just among themselves that we actually have two scholars this year, one of whom is with us tonight. And I'm going to invite our Vice Chancellor of the Dallas County Community College District up here in just a moment. And while he's coming up, here at Richland College, we take a whole person approach, connecting mind, body, and spirit. And in the culture of Dallas, probably the most spiritual thing that you can do is to pass the plate. And so we're going to pass the plate to add some more money to our scholarship fund. And so that's what's going on while Bill is going to introduce us to the man for whom the scholarship is made, and also introduce you to one of our scholars, Bill Tucker, Vice Chancellor of the Dallas County Community College District.
Thank you. I love to talk to groups and pass the plate at the same time. And actually, I probably missed my calling by not being Reverend Billy Bob. We're delighted to be here and to be a part of this. This is our third annual retreat. We have 42 people out at the Bishop Mason Retreat Center in Flower Mound, Texas. And we invite you to join us next year if you'd like to. The registration and all the information is operated through Richland College. As we entered into our second retreat, we decided that Richland College was a great supporter of ours, and we wanted to support Richland College and its students, so we decided to do a scholarship. And as it turned out, we ended up doing two scholarships. We decided to name that scholarship in honor of Dr. Richard Payne. Dr. Richard Payne actually is attributed with saving the Native American flute. He is a physician from Oklahoma, in Oklahoma City. He's now retired. And for 50 years or so, he collected Native American flutes and worked with the Native Americans to help restore the flute to their heritage. And so he actually saved it for all of us to enjoy, all of us who play it and all of us who listen to it, and certainly the Native American heritage itself. And he's a great gentleman. He has been in our retreat. This is the second year, and we'd like to introduce him standing here, sitting here. He has a collection in his home of over 1,000 flutes and whistles, and probably the number one collection in the world. And he invites people to come to his home and to play them and share them and handle them. And it's an extraordinary kind of sharing of very rare and instruments that are just not available anywhere. He has a video that's been made in his honor called Tubot. Tubot is a name given to him by the Native Americans. He's published. He does scholarly research on the flute and has traveled all over the world. And he's connected a sharing of his medicine with the peoples he's visited and at the same time has learned about their culture and their heritage and their musical instruments. Dr. Payne, we're really thrilled that you're with us. We are pleased that you allowed us to use your name and to honor you with this scholarship that we were putting together. We have with us, we gave two scholarships this year. I have to have my notes to remember the names for sure. Two people, Deepash Raina and Jaina Klein. Deepash could not be here. He has an illness in his family. In addition to receiving a scholarship, the two recipients also receive a complimentary registration to the Armadillo Flute Society's annual retreat, which we just discussed. But we do have one person who's been with us at the retreat, and she's enjoying it and learning how to play the flute. She is studying music. She is an RN, a mother who's come back to get a degree in music, planning on transferring to the University of North Texas at North Texas. And studying the clarinet, a performance clarinet. She is married and has four children, and I think one or two of her children are here with her this evening. So we'd like for Jaina Klein to stand so we can see you and honor you, Jane. There she is. We're thrilled to have her as part of our flute retreat and wish her well in her studies. And we'll be looking forward to performances performed by Jaina. Thank you, Dr. Mittelstadt, for allowing us to be a part of this. And we hope that this relationship will continue for a long time between the Armadillo Flute Society and Richland College.
I have a special presentation for you, and that is part of my multimedia performance territory. I just want to tell you a little bit about its conception before I begin. And for the last couple of years, I traveled around my home country reconnecting after not being there for many years and going off and becoming a recording artist and touring. And I felt like I'd had enough of that and I needed to touch base back home. So I did. And what it led me into was actually going deeper into my land and into the spirit of my ancestors than I'd ever been before. And what came out of that time, that experiential time, was a multimedia performance that is my dedication, my honouring of my country and the people that live there. I'm talking about the Aboriginal people of Australia. Territory has a dual meaning, as in the Northern Territory of Australia, where I'm from, and also territory, a sense of belonging, a sense of custodianship. And I filmed my country for 2 years. I went around in a car and filmed in my own time and recorded the sounds of nature and the environments that I found there. And many experiences that I had in these places led me to composing music, which you're going to hear some of that tonight. And so territory was 2 years of what I call a walkabout. And so it starts off with invoking the spirits, which is something that my elders taught me many, many years ago, was to invoke the spirits before a special time to make sure that they're there with us to partake in the ceremonial celebrations. So my first piece is called Invoking the Spirits. Thank you. Could I have the backing track up in my monitor, please? The backing track up in my monitor. What you're seeing here tonight is, as I said, a work of devotion for the last couple of years. And so all these pieces came through in that time of spending time in the land. And I composed all the tracks that you're hearing that are from my CD that you'll find outside called Territory. And so it's all part of the same package. These visuals, I shot about 75% of the footage you're going to see tonight, all from my country, my people. And I edited that all in my own time as well. So it was quite a large project to take on, but I'm quite happy to be able to bridge this way to people. I really felt like there was a need to do that. The Aboriginal culture is still seen as a bit of it's an enigma to people. People don't really know much about it. And the elders of my country are just now starting to release teachings and share knowledge with the Western world. And I think that's a very wonderful thing and a very needed thing. And to be able to capture it before it's completely gone is also one of our jobs, I think, for all of us. We all share that. And that's part of my job, was pulling together this show to be able to bring you to a place of context with my country and the spirit of my country. In the 2 years that I was filming, my grandmother passed away, and it's my grandmother that I owe everything in my life to, doing what I am doing, traveling the world at the moment. My current walkabout is all her spirit's with me. She passed away about a year ago this time, and I dedicate this next piece to her. This next piece is called Through the Eye of the Eagle, and it's about Mundawadi, our eagle, the white-breasted seagull. It's about the same size as the bald eagle of the United States. And for us, it's the cultural ambassador, and it takes our elders, when they passed away, to the sky world, to Great Bayame, which is our great spirit's name. And Mundawadi came to the people and promised one thing, that on the journey home, you will see and fly over your loved lands one more time on your journey home. So it was after my Nana passed away that I wrote this song and created this visual piece. So this is Mundawadi. You will be flying over the heart of my grandmother's country. And this one I dedicate to her. It's called Through the Eye of the Eagle. And at the start of the visual piece, you will see a huge eye of an eagle. And it gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger until it blacks out the screen. That means you, the audience, have become Mundawadi. And I invite you to fly over the heart of my country with me. You are. I'll have the backing track up a little bit more on my monitor, thank you. Just a couple of notches. One thing, you come and read about my culture, you come and visit us in my country, which is actually a better idea, isn't it? You'll come across a term a lot that we use, and that's dream time. Dream time. A lot of people ask me, well, Ash, what is that? What's that dream time? Is that when we're asleep? It's like, well, yes, that's part of it, but it's also when you're awake, too. See, dream time for us refers to a time of creation when the world was created, the physical world, the way that we see it, and the great ancestral beings and mythical spirits that helped in that creation. We are related to those ancestors. They're our ancestors, and through their stories and through their actions, they taught us the way to live and how to behave with one another in a beautiful way and in harmony with our environment. And it's by honoring these stories through dance and through ritual that we renew this on the earth again and again and again. And it's been this way throughout our history. So we hold the essence of the dream time. Right now, all of us here are dreaming. What is taking place now, the way we see it, is a dream. And our purpose in life, so my ancestors have passed on to me, is to simply recreate the original intent of the ancestors, to re-dream it constantly in every moment. I used to go out camping a lot during my journey filming this, and this is one of my favorite places I'm going to show you next. It's known as the Devil's Marbles. It's pretty much in the middle of the country, right in the desert area, and it's a group of rocks that are they're very large, rounded rocks piled up on top of one another like some giant has placed them there, like a marble set. But to the Wulpri people, it's a much different place. It's surrounded by a circular mountain, completely circular, and I've flown over it many times in a light plane and looked down on these things myself. And it is indeed a completely circular mountain. And there's two main rock piles there. One is a woman's place and one is a men's place. So in our culture, we have men's business and we have women's business, and they're separated and they're secret from one another. They're different societies of life. And we, depending on our gender, partake in each one of these areas. I've filmed the men's area that I'm allowed to show you. This is a very sacred place to the Wulpri area. What it actually is the rainbow serpent, one of the greatest figures in our dreamtime mythology, surrounding her eggs, protecting them in the central desert areas. So it's a very, very powerful story. I used to go there and camp all the time, and I used to sleep on the highest rock formation. And I used to have these incredible dreams there. I used to do this every Tuesday night. And my dreams would be always very intense. It took me many months to realize they weren't my dreams. I was dreaming what the rocks were dreaming, what they were showing me in the dream time, from the dream time, during my dreaming. And sleeping on a place is a good way to connect ourselves to it. And sleeping on top of the rocks in what we call a swag. That's just a roll that we throw down on the ground. So these were my experiences, and I wanted to be true to that and bring forth a visual piece that really had the characteristics of the sort of dreams that I was experiencing. So you'll see many of the animals that live here, including the famous emu that lives in Central Australia as well. So please enjoy this piece, Dreamstones.
Yeah.
Next piece I have for you is called Walkabout, and it really tells the story of what I actually did for 2 years creating this. And the walkabout is a term that we use in Aboriginal Australia. Is then we got a feeling to go somewhere. We just get up and go there. It's as simple as that. You see, we don't get in the way of that feeling. When that feeling comes to us in here, we've got to go somewhere. There's a real good reason why we've got to go there, because Spirit's calling us there. So this is the whole concept of walkabout. It's when we feel like we've got to go somewhere, we just simply go somewhere. And this always leads us to the place where we're meant to be. It's a very simple concept, but it's one a lot of people have a really hard time following. And you just simply get up and you do it. So this is the story of the walkabout. And actually, I must tell a story first. Living in this place called Tennant Creek, a very small town in Australia, about 3,000 people, survives by some gold mines around the area. And a lot of tourists used to come through all the time, driving down what we call the Stuart Highway. It's the road that cuts Australia in half, straight from north down to the south. And people would get lost all the time. They'd go out, they'd get out of their camper vans, and they'd walk into the bush. And of course, everything looks the same once you get a couple of hundred meters away from the car, and you turn around, all of a sudden forget where you are, and it's, even though the car's just there, it's very hard to find your way back to it. So people getting lost all the time. And there was one old fella there, an elder that I met. His name was Jimmy Nothing. He was a Woolpuri man. And every time I used to meet him in town, I'd say, "Hey, Jimmy, what you doing?" He'd go, "Nothing. Nothing." I go, "Okay, old man." But I knew he'd been on a walkabout. And every time these people would get lost, he would show up, bring him back into town. It was always that way. He was a magic man. One time he stood on my foot and holding two boomerangs, he clapped and them together and sung a power song into me. So I feel really connected to this area and this sense of what a walkabout is. So here we go. You're going to see a lot of Central Australia in this one too. It's all mostly red.
I'm going to go.
just keep rolling into the next one. Thanks. Thank you. Yeah, we've lost some tourists recently in a Northern Territory, and you know, it's a pretty simple matter really when you see a sign by all the waters that has a picture of this and a picture of this, and around the picture of what I'm doing now is a big red circle with a cross through it. It's pretty simple to understand, isn't it? So you come up to my country, my backyard, and you'll see a lot of these things. And saltwater estuarine crocodiles, they're amazing, very, very powerful creatures. But they do share their environment with many, many other species of animals and long-necked snapping turtles, many species of snakes, and a lot of migratory birds that come in during the wet season. So it's a very wonderful place, very, very alive. And it's safe if you get in the tourist boats and, you know, you can travel around on the water safely and have a look at the habitats that abound there. And in the river systems, just to give you an idea of how many crocs there are there, there's about 5 crocodiles every 100 metres. And they're very, very territorial, so they haven't got much room to move around. And when the water goes down about November time, the water goes down, it hasn't rained in a while, it's called the dry season. There's only 2 seasons, by the way, in my country. It's hot and real bloody hot. So, and when it's real bloody hot, of course it's not raining, so the water goes down, down, down like this. And the crocodiles, they lose a lot of their territorial space because the water's gone down so much. So that's the time that you'll see them actually fighting. That's some of the footage that I took of them just last year. And when the rains come up again, just when you know where all the crocodiles are, oh, there's one in that billabong over there, and there's one in that river over there, and oh, there's one where our favourite fishing spot, so we can't go fishing there this year, and but it's safe to go swimming there. And then all of a sudden the rains come up and everything floods, and it's just water everywhere. And all the crocodiles, they get up and they move all different places. And then the water goes back down again. You think it's safe to swim there anymore? No. We don't know. We have to go and check every single year. And that's what life's like up there, living on the reserves. This next piece is a very, very simple visual piece. It's actually a standalone shot done in real time at the Woolpree Dreaming Area that I showed before, the Devil's Marbles. And this is my challenge to you during this piece, actually, is to see if you can see the colours changing in real time. It's so subtle. But we start off a very basic colours, and we get to these incredible colours on the rocks, like they're glowing from the inside, like on hot coals. And this is the story of the first sunrise in the morning for our people. That is a very, very beautiful thing. And the sun goddess, for us, the sun is a grandmother, gave us this special light first thing in the morning. And it was a special gift to us so that we could appreciate how beautiful the world was. Ye said, oh, I'm going to give my children a very special gift, this light, but it's only going to be there a short time, and they're going to see really all the colours and just how beautiful it is, paradise that I made for them. And everyone slept in the first day. No one saw it. So Ye never gets angry with the children. She says, well, okay, I'm going to have to get someone to help me wake everybody up. So she goes to Goo Goo Gaga, the kookaburra, and says, hey, out of all the bird tribes, you have the loudest voice. So I need your help first thing in the morning. Goo Goo Gaga thinks everything's funny. He says, yeah, sure. So the next morning, bang, the sound of the kookaburra. Everybody wakes up and sees this special, beautiful light that's bathing everything in this magical colour. And today, actually, the kookaburra down south is known as the Bushman's Alarm Clock. Before dawn, every morning. And when you get 10 of them together sitting around you in the gum trees, it's like this. I'd like to invite Peter Phippen up here with me to share in this dawn chorus. So you're going to hear the sounds of the kookaburras. And I was out there and I recorded the Gordian finches and also the magpie, which in our country has one of the most beautiful songs. And I'd like to invite Peter up here to accompany me on this song. Thanks, Peter. I'm going to start off this piece with the emu egg. I'm going to play through this microphone.
Oh,
This is Peter, please stay on stage with me for this next piece. This is my final visual piece for you tonight, and it's about the Mimi spirits. In Kakadu National Park, you'll see some of the oldest rock art in the world displayed there in immense galleries. And it's part of the border between Kakadu National Park and the largest Aboriginal reserve in Australia called the Arnhem Land, one of the traditional homes of this instrument, which in my language, by the way, is Mama Lima. Mama Lima. Can everyone say that? Mama Lima. So not didgeridoo. Mama Lima. And the Mimis are shy spirits that live in the rocks, and they're very, very tall. They're 20 feet tall. And they only come out at night time when it's very, very still, because if there's too much wind, they'll break. And the old people, they still know the songs, how to open up the doorways in the rocks to bring them out. But they're magical beings, and they're very, very friendly. And the old stories are that they taught us language, they taught us how to make tools for life, and they taught us many, many dances. And they're from the stars originally, and they have a strange language that nobody knows anymore. So, but we're going to speak that language tonight. So this is Mimi.
Oh,
Thank you. Thank you very much, and thank you, Peter. That's part of my show, and this is as much as we've got time for in the second half tonight. And we'd like to actually conclude by bringing everyone back on stage. And I'd like to remind you that both Peter and I have CDs for sale. If you haven't grabbed one already, please do. My CD is the music from the show, some of which you've just heard. And now I'd like to welcome back on our full band. And we've got one piece that we'd like to play for you in an honour for you coming here tonight. So thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Steve.
That concludes tonight's performance. Thank you, everyone. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you, Richland College. Thank you, Steve, for inviting us all down here. Thank you to the Armadillo Flute Circle. And thank you to all of you for showing up tonight. It's been a pleasure.